And it was with William the Conqueror that the Jews came into England for the first time in numbers. And it wasn't until King Edward Longshanks evicted them in 1290 AD that the Jews were expelled. And then just before the English Revolution, the Jews started to come back in. And Mr. Carvajal was a famous Jew there in London. According to the history of the Bevis Marks Synagogue in London that was built by Jews soon after they were allowed to legally return to England in 1664, Abraham Israel Fernandez Carvajal had originally settled in London around 1632 as a Portuguese Jew posing as a Portuguese Murano Catholic. These Sephardic Jews moved into the Iberian Peninsula with the Celts when they moved there, all the way from Idumea in the southern part of Judea. Like many Muranos living around the Lisbon, Portugal area, he had grown wealthy from the slave trade between Africa and America and back to the ports of Europe. The London Jews say Mr. Carvajal is sometimes called the first English Jew or the Great Jew, who with a group of about 20 Murano families lived in London. At the time in London, the Goose and Gridiron Owl House, which was situated there in St. Paul's Churchyard, was a Masonic lodge. The Goose and Gridiron eventually moved to the King or Queen's Arms Tavern and later became the West Indian and American Lodge. According to the author Abby LaRudin, the Crown Owl House in Parker's Lane near Drury Lane is where Oliver Cromwell met as a Mason. Together with the two other lodges, the Apple Tree and Rummer and Grapes, on the 24th of June 1717, these four lodges formed the Grand Lodge of London, which became the first Grand Orient Jewish lodge in the British Commonwealth. Anyway, prior to the Jews being legally entitled to stay in England, the Murano Jewish merchants helped finance and support Oliver Cromwell's new army, made up of local dissidents, German mercenaries and Jewish money. This allowed for Oliver Cromwell to fight the English Civil War against Charles I and brought about the English Revolution, which culminated in Charles I, the Scottish King, being executed for treason. This is what happened. On the 16th of June 1647, Oliver Cromwell wrote a letter to another Murano Jew living in Mulheim, Germany, called Ebenezer Pratt. The letter was found in 1813 by Napoleon Bonaparte in a synagogue in Mulheim, which is how it became public. It says, in return for financial support, we'll advocate admission of the Jews. This is impossible while Charles is still alive. It was Ebenezer Pratt who drafted the charges for Oliver Cromwell to bring against Charles I for treason, when really Oliver Cromwell was the traitor all along. In December of 1648, the Rump Parliament of England was formed when the majority of the parliamentarians who were Scottish Presbyterians were purged, and so democracy was usurped. The only remaining members were called the Levellers, who were the Freemasons who one of Charles I tried and executed. Hence the name was given the Rump Parliament, meaning or the arse end of Parliament. In return for assistance, Oliver promised the Jews that he would help them rebuild the Temple of Solomon in Jerusalem, as well as allow the Jews back into England. None of those promises he kept. And the Anabaptists criticised Cromwell for the messianic way he presented himself to the Jews. In 1645, Mr. Carvajal was denounced by an informer for not attending a Protestant church, but was defended by the leading merchants of the day, and so the House of Lords quashed the proceedings. Meanwhile, the Civil War in England was playing out, and eventuated in Charles I being executed in January 1649. When the Anglo-Spanish War began in 1655, Cromwell seized all property belonging to the Spaniards living in its territory, but when another Jew, Antonio Rodriguez Robles, found himself denounced and threatened with the loss of all of his property, Carvajal led the entire Sephardic community to appeal to Cromwell and the Council State to recognize them as Jewish refugees rather than as Catholic Murano Spaniards. Suddenly they admitted to being Jews and were granted permission to stay in London. In 1657, Rabbi Manasseh ben Israel petitioned Oliver Cromwell to readmit the Jews legally back into England. Cromwell appointed an assembly of lawyers and divines to look into the matter. They came back in favour. However, the existing English merchants regarded the Jews as competition and were opposed to it. And so it was Charles II who legally had readmitted the Jews in 1664. Charles II was thankful for the support some Jews in Holland had given him. 2 years later, in 1666, the Fire of London took place, which wiped out the commercial centre of the City of London, and by 1694 the Jews owned the Private Bank of England, and by 1695 the Bank of Scotland as well. And so both during and after the English Revolution, the Celtic nations of Ireland and Scotland were particularly targeted by the English. And we know that Oliver Cromwell travelled to Ireland and created Northern Ireland, and soon after the Protestants established the Orange Lodge there of the Orangemen in Northern Ireland. And also we know that the Battle of Culloden took place in Scotland, where the Scottish were defeated. And so this meant the dispersion of all the Scots, and they became the mercenary soldiers who went out to India. And we know that they weren't allowed to have a kilt or a bagpipe or a gun or speak their Gaelic language anymore. And so it was this network of Morano Jews that started to help Oliver Cromwell in the English Revolution. And so let's have a look now at the history of the English Revolution.
Yeah.
And so with the formation of the Bank of England in 1694 began the expansion of the British Commonwealth, because Jewish money was pouring into London at that time, and they expanded as far east as India, where the whole of Calcutta incident took place, and also to China with the Opium Wars, and down to South Africa and Australia and New Zealand at the opposite end of the world. But the biggest jewel of the British colonies was the United States of America.